Thank you so much for agreeing to do this interview. And first of all, let me really start with saying I've never met a female bishop before.
So I'm the first one.
You are the first one, yes. And I realize there's not even a word in English for a female bishop, it's just female bishop, right? Yeah. So is there a word in Georgian?
No, just... In Georgian, we don't really have grammatical gender or linguistic gender. We're very lucky in this regard. So we don't really need much headache about the whether the word is male or female. So bishop is bishop, episcopacy would go for man and woman. But
that's very lucky in this one. Okay, so can you maybe explain how that happened, how you became a female bishop, or maybe start off by explaining why you wanted to become a bishop?
Oh, I didn't want.
You didn't want to?
Well, the story was like this. I was brought up in the Baptist church. I was brought up in the Baptist pastor's family. My grandfather was a pastor. My uncle was a bishop. So I was brought up in a clerical family. So I was very much aware what it means to be a minister in the church, what it means when people come to you and bring their pains and sorrows, and how grandpa would listen to them. At some point, when I was staying with my grandparents, I was too little, and when the confession thing would happen, they would not bother if I would be in the room. So sometimes I would witness some very odd conversations. So I was very much there. I could feel what it means to serve people. So at some point when I was asked by the leader of the church to think about my ordination. So probably the biggest decision was when I was ordained as a deacon. So that was I was all the time I was in the church. I was doing something either with the Sunday school or with youth or with liturgy. But to be a minister, it's absolutely different responsibility and. You're not a helper, but you bear a much important burden. So to make that decision was not easy. I had to talk. I had my already had my two children at that time. They were very young. I talked to my husband. I talked to my children. They had no clue what that meant, what I was telling them, but. They were happy. They were happy that I asked, and we talked. So probably they thought that it would be fun to have a clergy mother. So that was how it started. And at some point, when the leader of the church called me, not only me but three of us, two, my male colleagues and myself, and he said that, "What if we start pray and to think and to elaborate in our minds the idea of ordaining as bishops." So we started our pilgrimage, our conversation with the boss. I had my concern. I was very young. To start a barely career at 33, you're already old, but to be ordained as bishop when you are 33, it's too young. And my kids were young, and I was young, so I said, I'm honored for asking me, but probably I would wait some 10 more years. But I had a very interesting response saying, 33 is a good age for crucifixion. The governing body of the Baptist Church in Georgia is Synod. which consists of clergy and lay people, men and women. And the head of the church introduced these three names to the synod. And there were not a single objection in the synod. They all accepted, they supported all three of us from the very beginning. And that was also an answer for me, that I could do this. So it's 10th year already, and it was a very interesting year in my life, about 10 years in my life. That's the story.
That's very impressive. And you said that in the Senate, everyone supported you from the start. Did you, apart from that experience, did you ever have any negative response to you being a female bishop, or did you ever feel as if people weren't respecting you?
Both inside and outside the church. Well, some people said, don't you read the Bible? Don't you read what Paul says about women? That he's not allowing women to teach in the church? And I said, oops, or is it really in the gospel? Well, of course there were objections in the church. I was told a couple of people who left the church because they said that we're not going to be part of the church who's ordaining women. So there was some objection. And outside the church, those who thought that Baptists are crazy sectarians, for them, ordination of women was one of the issues to prove that idea. And for those who thought that all Protestantism and Baptists are very interesting, they have very interesting theology about equality, this ordination was for them a good example of what we teach, what we preach. So it didn't, I don't think it did really change the atmosphere outside the church. Those who wanted to oppose the church, they continued.
What do you say to people like that? You say, don't you read the Bible? Do you reply at all? And if so, what do you say?
I don't reply, because it's not the yes or no answer. Because if people don't want to listen, they don't listen. And Christianity is not about fighting with the verses from the scripture. Those who are really interested, and those who say, you know, I thought Christianity don't accept women's ordination, then how do we find this in the Bible? Then I know that they really want my answer. And then I talk, then I explain that the same Paul, the same person, who says to Corinthians, to particular church, for a certain reason, I don't allow women to teach in the church because there were certain problems in the church. The same Paul says there is no man or woman, there is no Jew or Greek, there is no slave or free person in Jesus. The same Paul speaks in Romans about his colleague, women colleagues who were pastors, who were in prison because of preaching the gospel. It's the same person, I mean. And if the conversation is longer, then I speak what Jesus says about women, what Jesus does about women. So, of course, there are verses that can prove one position, and there are verses that can prove another position. And to find out which is right or which is wrong, it means that it's not about fighting or making a deal with the verses, but it's about how we view God. God who is just and loving, and I don't think that justice and love is revealed in hierarchical creation of humans. So I talk a lot when I'm asked.
When you ask seriously.
Yeah, if they ask seriously. If people just want to argue, I can talk to them.
I heard that you met Michelle Obama, is that right?
You did. She's very tall.
She's very tall.
Very tall.
And I heard that she gave you a prize, right? Can you explain about that a little bit?
Since 2007, the State Department gives a Woman of Courage Award to 10 women from all over the world where the United States have embassies. So this is the embassy project. Embassies would nominate people from the countries they operate, and then there's a shortlisting, and so at the end of the process, 10 women are selected and 10 women are awarded. So in 2014, I was honored to receive that award. And that was the time when there were different turmoils happening in the country.
Mm-hmm.
First was anti-Muslim turmoil. Islamophobia took the ugliest forms in the country. In one of the Muslim villages, the Christian neighbors attacked Imam's family and beat the wife and frightened the kids and the family. In another village, the minaret was cut down in West Georgia, in Najaf, in Kobuleti, and the Christian neighbors took the pig's head and nailed on the door of the mosque. So these were terrible things. How Christians pictured the image of Jesus was just unbearable. So that was one turmoil. Another was homophobia, and probably you have heard what happened in Tbilisi on May 17 in 2013, when about 30, 40 young people wanted to come to the meeting to say that we are against homophobia. And these couple of dozen of young people were attacked by about 30,000 people led by hundreds of Orthodox clergy. These two topics were very important for our church, and we spoke out and we protected those who needed our protection. So because of what our church did towards combating Islamophobia and combating homophobia and protecting the women's rights. So these were the three issues why I was awarded.
Did that give you new possibilities to fight what was happening here or to speak out against it?
Well, both. This experience, this award, in certain situation was something that gave a louder voice to my words, and I could speak directly to international organizations, to embassies, and this is the one who was awarded. So it helped. But on the other hand, in some situations it didn't really help a positive role, because people say, oh, you did because you wanted to gain an award, and probably they thought that the award would mean something, I don't know, or we knew that you were the US spy here, so that was also a privilege.
And did it make your position towards the Georgian state or the Orthodox Church more difficult?
Orthodox Church was very upset because of the award. They said that by awarding a Baptist woman bishop was a humiliation of Georgian nation, Georgian culture, Georgian religion. So they made even the statements in newspapers that it was a provocative step from the U.S. embassy and automatically.
Maybe let's talk about interreligious dialogue for a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
So our delegation from House of One obviously went to the service, and we saw that you have a corner for Jews and Muslims within the cathedral.
Mm-hmm.
Can you explain about that?
When we first spoke to the congregation about the idea to have a space for Muslims to come and pray there and space for Jews within the cathedral, there was one very interesting question. Somebody raised her hand and asked, where do we find Muslims to come and pray here? Don't they have their own mosques, or are they going to leave their mosques and come keep coming in our church? That was a very important signal. So it's not about converting somebody to interreligious whatever. That space for Jews, for Christians, for Muslims. This is a declaration, what we believe. And first of all, this is not for Muslims or for Jews, but for us to learn that God loves everybody. And His love is not limited with the walls that we people have built around our religion. So this is a learning experience for everybody who comes to our church. I remember when first we started to sing Fatiha, it was, for some of the people, it was not easy saying, okay, we don't beat up Muslims, that it doesn't mean that we are going to, we are supposed to sing their songs in the church. But we decided to put this celebration of diversity, not only in our words, but in architecture, in music, in prayers, in our liturgy, Eucharist liturgy. We have Rustavelis verbs, Shota Rustavelis, a 12th century Georgian poet, and his poem, The Night in the Panther's Skin, is the treasure of Georgian culture, and this poem speaks about the universe of the variety of colors, and this diversity and richness of diversity is revealed in the poem. So we have the verses from that poem, and on the other hand we have Jalal ad-Din Rumi's verse in the liturgy, and I can see whenever we read the liturgy, when we start Rustavelli, the eyes of Orthodox guests who are in they start, is it really Rustavelli or when we read the Rumi, if we have Muslim guests, I can feel their reaction from their eyes. So you can speak on conferences, and of course this dimension is very important. Conversation, theological dialogue, but liturgy and music and art and architecture speak. speaks an absolutely different language, which is the language of the heart. It's not the intellectual language, it's the feeling, language of feelings, and it works. It works very, very much, both for us and for those who come to participate.
That sounds so nice. And also when we experienced that, it was so nice. You explained to us that for you it's obvious that women are equal within Christianity because of what Paul said, or Jesus said himself. Do you ever think that being a woman, or being a woman in your position, can be an obstacle to interreligious dialogue? Because obviously there are very conservative views about women in Christianity, but also in other religions. So do you ever feel that that prevents you from successful dialogue?
It has been an obstacle in even in ecumenical relationships in Georgia. In the beginning, I was not very much on stage. I mean, if there was a, for instance, ecumenical prayer, I would be rather as part of the congregation rather than to show dressed up and clearly, because we didn't really want to provoke. In the situation when the ecumenical relations are fragile enough, we didn't really want to make it the situation even hard. But I remember the feeling in 2011, the Parliament of Georgia adopted a new law about the religious about the registration of religious communities. So everybody we're given an opportunity to be registered as a religious community. So it was a quite a reformative step for the government and from the legislation, Georgian legislation. And somehow it happened that amendment led to the Armenophobia in the country. The reason was just a week before, Armenian patriarch was visiting Georgia, and he met with the leader of the political leaders as well as with the religious leaders. So somehow people decided, well, it was not just average people, but it was quite a good plan to direct all this aggression against Armenians. It happened so that I became somehow in the center of these turmoils, and Armenian church was very much reluctant to participate in TV shows because they were afraid that if they start talking about something, the aggression would grow. So I had to protect Armenians on debates, so I was somehow then the journalists realized, oh, there is this strange woman who is bishop. So before that, the society wouldn't know about my existence. So after that experience, the next ecumenical prayer, during the next ecumenical prayer, in Georgia we would have a rotation where the host of the prayer would be Armenian church, the next day Catholic church, the next day Lutheran church or Baptist church. These four churches would rotate the year after year. So that year was time for an Armenian church. That was the first time when they asked me, and not only me, but also the women from Salvation Army, and other women who were already in the church to stand in front of the altar next to the male clergy who were all the time there. So it really changed. Situation really changed when they felt that it's not about the political game, whether this church ordains women or we don't ordain. they find out that we are a family. We are the family who, and our family is this country. So that really changed the situation, and I could feel that every step, even with the Muslims. When the minaret was cut down, and those Muslims, the young people, oh, not only Muslims, the neighbors who live, the Christians, oh, we also trying to protect the minaret from cutting down. All these guys were arrested. So there was a huge meeting in Achatziche in front of the police stations where they arrested the young men we are kept. So Bishop Malchas, myself, and our Muslim friend Ariel Magaiza probably met. We went there to meet the people. I was not dressed as a clergy, I was just in my casual outfit, and there were no women, absolutely, only the men were standing and shouting and everything. So, and I just followed Malchas and Ariel, and they went in the middle of these debates, somehow I also said something, I don't remember what was that. And one of the elders of this Muslim community turned to me and said, "And are you a journalist?" And I said, because they thought probably she's a journalist, well, that's why she dared to come in the middle of all these men. And I said, "No, I'm not a journalist. And what is your name?" And I said, "I'm Rusudan Kutsidit." And I remember his face, how he changed, and he hugged me. And he says, "I know who you are. I have heard what you said here and there. I a minute before I thought that I would be kicked out of the circle." And so it is an obstacle to have a female clergy, but sometimes it is not.
So it's really just a case of getting to know the people.
Absolutely.
Once they know you.
Absolutely. Even more, our Muslim friends, when they know that how we treat women, how we treat equality, how we value equality, and when they want to have some movements within their community, they send their women to our conferences. So challenge can be converted into a new chance. So we try to find all these channels and challenges to convert to the chances.
That is so great. I was wondering if you could maybe give us some advice or a message or something that you want us to know for the work at the House of Horn from your experience with Peace Cathedral.
I would not dare to give to share or to give advice or something. I just want to share my feeling when I first heard about your project, about the House of One. I had this feeling that we are not alone in this world with these crazy ideas. There are other crazy people, and this is an encouragement. And probably the best thing would be there are a lot of other people all around the world, and we need to find all of them. And this is something which is badly needed in our modern times, where the religious conflicts are all around, and even the very tolerant Europe is getting so afraid of diversity, and the so tolerant United States is getting so afraid of migrants, of people of different races. So it's kind of going backwards rather than going forward. And I think we have few in comparison with the rest of the civilization, but it's not about the numbers. We just need to find the allies all over the world. you just don't know it.
It's such a nice note to end on.